So good morning to you all, and today we will be focusing on protein expression, okay, recombinant protein expression. Have you encountered the term recombinant protein expression or heterologous gene expression before? Never. What does it relate to in your, based on your prior knowledge, what does protein expression? So recombinant protein expression or heterologous protein expression or heterologous gene expression essentially means we isolate a gene from one source, a protein coding gene from maybe from a eukaryote or prokaryotic system, and we express it in another system. That's why it's called heterologous protein expression. It's transfer of a gene encoding a protein from a eukaryotic to a prokaryotic system or from one kingdom to another. For example, a gene from a plant expressed in a fish, okay, things like that, or a gene from a fish expressed in a plant. Why do you need to do that? For instance, I want to express a gene which is expressed in a plant in a bacterial host. Why do I need to do that? What's the reason for that?
Maybe there's some beneficial use, like maybe you want to produce enzyme or hormones or something.
Yes, you essentially want to upscale production. So sometimes a protein which is very critical for certain processes, for instance, as you mentioned, an enzyme. This enzyme may be produced in a plant at a very, very low concentration, okay, because the plant doesn't require this enzyme to survive. So it produces only trace amounts of this enzyme. So what we do as biotechnologists, we find or look for the gene encoding this particular enzyme, and we isolate this gene of interest and we express it in another host. Okay, this host can be a bacteria, it can be a yeast, it can be a plant, it can be even a moss or a worm. Okay, so we select the host based on certain criteria. So when I have a gene, this is a 5 prime, 3 prime end, so you have a gene. We essentially have to ensure that this one has an open reading frame. An open reading frame is a triplet of DNA coding sequences which will result in translation into an amino acid sequence. So you have your DNA sequence and it should be translated, or it has to be translated into an amino acid sequence. So this amino acid sequence will then form your protein, and other processes such as protein folding will render the protein biologically active. What you have to understand is when you have an amino acid sequence which is not folded correctly, you will not have a function assigned to it. Suppose you have an amino acid sequence which encodes a protein, but you did not refold it. It needs to be refolded into the correct configuration in order to be functional. You take the example of an enzyme. An enzyme may be composed of more than 2000 amino acids. However, only a small portion of these which encompass what is known as the catalytic domain. Okay, that's the catalytic domain. That's where the functionality is assigned. Okay. So you have a big protein, a large protein, but only a small section of this is the part or the component which binds to the substrate. For example, you have an enzyme which may bind to a glucose or a fructose or hexokinase molecule. You have a molecule like that. So you have an enzyme which will bind to a particular molecule and then it will elicit its specific function. Okay, so that's the way the proteins function. So when you decide, or when you decide to design an experiment to express genes in from one system in another system, you shuttle them to, you need to take certain things into consideration. I have given you the example earlier of how a human gene encoding a specific enzyme may not be expressed correctly in the bacteria. Do you remember what I mentioned about the gene? when you shuttle it from one system to another, for example, a gene from eukaryote shuttled into a prokaryote, will it express readily, easily? No. Why not? One of the reason is the presence of the introns. Okay. So if you have a gene from eukaryote which essentially contains introns and exons, the bacterial system cannot splice these introns and exons out. So the gene will not be transcribed and you will not have translation into the protein. So that's what happens with intron-exon boundary. The second aspect which needs to be considered is codon optimization. Some of the codons which are readily understood by the eukaryotic translation machinery may not be understood by the bacterial host. So these genes will essentially be transferred. You transfer them to E. coli, but there will be no expression because the codon usage is different. Because this, when we are working as biotechnologists, we take a lot of, we lay a lot of emphasis on the usage of proper codon. Because if the codons are not proper, means the codon usage is not appropriate, the bacteria may produce the amino acid sequence. However, some of the amino acids which are in the chain may be different. So that will cause a problem because you may not have the expression or the function of the enzyme. So that's what we need to consider. So how will you isolate a gene of interest from a eukaryote, an intronless gene of interest? So we have a eukaryotic gene which consists of exons and introns. So if I asked you how you would isolate this gene of interest, you will say PCR. So if you want to shuttle a gene, for instance, from a human into a plant, okay, you have a with an intron and exon, you can use the PCR product itself. This is because the plant has the ability to splice the introns and exons. Okay, so the gene is derived from a human being. You want to express it in plants, the plant can splice out the introns and exons. If I want to express this gene in bacteria, what do I do? The bacteria cannot splice out the introns and exons. So how do I isolate the protein coding or the amino acid coding sequence?
Splice out first the intron before.
Yeah. Splice out the introns and exons. So, in order to do this, you don't work with the gene of interest, you work with the messenger RNA or the what is the mature messenger RNA. How do you isolate mature messenger RNA in eukaryotes? You use the polyadenylated PL. So, you have an oligo-DT primer which will prime the sequence. You have a reverse transcriptase which will convert the mRNA sequence into the complementary DNA strand, as I explained to you all during reverse transcription. So you have your complementary DNA. Do you remember the process? So you have your reverse transcriptase followed by your RNase H, which will generate mismatch, and then you will have your DNA polymerase 1 clino fragment which will fill in the gaps. So now you have your cDNA sequence. You can sequence it to verify that it's the gene of interest, and then you can clone it into a vector. You transfer it into a vector, you can express this in bacteria. So you have your cDNA sequence, you ligate it onto a plasmid, you transform this plasmid into bacteria like E. coli, and you will have expression of that gene of interest. So this is the process of heterologous protein expression. We will go through this entire process during the lecture. Okay. We go through in a step by step. This is because there are certain stages which are critical. For instance, if you have a single mismatch in your cDNA sequence, E. coli will not translate that protein. Okay, because the intact reading, open reading frame is not intact. Okay, so these things need to be taken into consideration when you do your heterologous gene expression. Okay, coming down to the expression system, we have many systems which express or can be harnessed to express proteins. The most common one is Escherichia coli, because Escherichia coli, it grows very rapidly. Okay, you can grow it in a bioreactor and you can get protein yields on overnight culture. Okay, it's inducible, means you can switch on the expression using specific chemicals. In addition to Escherichia coli, the other expression system which is used widely by researchers is the yeast expression system. So we have yeast such as Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is the common baker's yeast, as well as yeast such as Pitcher pastoris, which is a alcohol, it requires alcohol for fermentation, like methanol driven fermentation. So these yeasts can be used for expression of proteins. E. coli will express proteins at a very high concentration. In a conventional culture, on a shake flask culture at 37 degrees, you get up to 25 to 200 milligrams of crude protein per liter. Whereas if you expressed in yeast, the expression level will be far, far lower. It may be 1/10 or 1/100 of that expressed in E. coli. This is because yeast have a system whereby they express the gene only after it's integrated into the genome. So in the case of E. coli, your plasmid copy number is very high. So if you have more plasmids, obviously you will have more transcription and translation of the gene of interest. However, in the case of yeast, the gene of interest has to be integrated into the genome. So the yield of the protein from the yeast will be directly proportional to the number of times it integrates into the yeast chromosome. Okay, so if you have a more integration or higher number of integrative events, you will have more protein. Okay, so that will give you a basis of on which to found your understanding of protein expression. Okay, so you're clear about the process of protein expression now. You have a somewhat clearer understanding of what protein expression is. So heterologous protein expression basically involves the transfer of a gene from one system, which may be a eukaryotic or prokaryotic system, into another system. Once you transfer your gene into the second system, it needs to be expressed. So the expression is driven by specific factors. One of the factors which you need to consider is the fact regarding the intron exon sequences. Okay, the second factor which you need to consider is the codon usage. So this will give you an overview of what you are expected to learn during your lecture. Okay, thank you.